Back to another lecture of Dental Pathshala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And this is a continuation of the Express Revision course for periodontics. And if you're interested in watching more videos, you can watch in the playlist, and also you can check out the link provided in the description below for the notes of this particular video. And if you are looking for more interesting notes, you can also check out our website www.xtool.com. So let's get started with the today's topic, which is the trauma from occlusion. Before we get started, make sure you subscribe to the channel and hit on the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our future videos. So guys, trauma from occlusion. So before starting with the trauma from occlusion, let's understand the two concepts. One is the Weyerhaeuser concept and another one is the Glickman concept. And again, Glickman is the person who is going to give the classification of the trauma from occlusion. So the Weyerhaeuser concept says that the amount of the plaque is directly proportional to the destruction of the bone. That means more the amount of plaque, more is the bone destruction. So this is the surface morphology of the tooth. Here guys, we have calculus. So suppose this is the calculus, then we have got the attached and the unattached plaque to it. So suppose this is the plaque. Now in the bottom we have the alveolar bone. So suppose this is the alveolar bone here. So this part is the calculus and here is the plaque, attached plaque. So guys, the distance between the apical end of the calculus and up till the alveolar bone in the pocket is constant in humans. So up till here, this is what do we call the biological width. On an average it is, so this is the biological width, this distance from the apical end of the calculus and the alveolar bone in the human of the pocket. So this is the biological width, and this biological width on an average we take 1.97 millimeters according to Carranza. Plus minus, it can be plus minus 33%. So Weyerhaeuser told that, he told that the distance from the attached plaque to the bone, so he gave the distance from the plaque to the bone. So distance from the plaque to the bone, this is the distance which is 0.5, minimum it is 0.5 millimeter and maximum it is 2.7 millimeter. So this distance was given by the Weyerhaeuser. So he measured the distance between the subgingival plaque and the inflammatory cell infiltrate and the surface of the alveolar bone. So basically the Weyerhaeuser measured this distance, and this is the distance from the plaque to the bone, alveolar bone, crest of the bone. So Weyerhaeuser said that the amount of plaque is directly proportional to destruction of the bone. He said occlusal forces are not at all important for the destruction of the bone, important for the periodontitis. He said that periodontitis is majorly because of the plaque accumulation, majorly because of the inflammation. And according to the Glickman, there are two zones. So according to the Glickman guys, there are two zones. So two zones. One is the zone of irritation, which is the marginal and the interdental gingiva, that is the coronal part, and another one is the zone of the destruction. Destruction according to Glickman. So if we have to draw these zones, this is the tooth, then we have the gingiva right here, and then we have the bone. So guys, there are two zones according to Glickman. One is the zone of the irritation. So this is the one which is present in the coronal part is the zone of the irritation. And another one is the zone of the destruction. So this is the zone of the irritation, and in the bottom we have is the zone of the destruction. So the zone of irritation and the zone of destruction. So zone of irritation is the marginal and the interdental gingiva. So because inflammatory cells seeps into this area when there is a bacteria, right? So because of the bacteria, inflammatory cell seeps into this area, and therefore there is an inflammation which we see in case of zone of irritation. So in the zone of irritation we see that there is an inflammation which is because of the irritation of the bacteria. So this is the irritation zone, is due to the inflammation, not due to the trauma from occlusion. So this zone is not affected by the occlusal forces, while the other zone, which is the zone of the destruction, contains PDL, cementum, alveolar bone. So the transeptal and the dentogingival fibers, so in the TFO, these from the one tooth to another tooth. So this is the zone of the co-destruction. So here in the zone of destruction, what happens? There is a lot of destruction which happens. And we have studied that as long as the inflammation is confined to the gingiva, as long as inflammation is confined to this irritation zone, so there is it is not affected by the occlusal forces. But what happens, guys, when the gingivitis become periodontitis? So the plaque induced inflammation enter this zone which is influenced by the occlusion. So what happens when there is an infiltration due to the plaque or the calculus into this area, which is due to the occlusal forces? So occlusal forces positive, due to the occlusal forces we see that there is inflammation of the periodontitis, widening of the PDL, all these things, and most importantly there is a angular bone loss. And the other side, when the inflammation goes the other side, so like this, then there is a horizontal bone loss is what do we observe. So the zone of destruction basically is due to the occlusal forces when there is a plaque induced inflammation, and this inflammation due to the occlusal forces enters into the space and there is a destruction happens. So there is a angular bone loss. So this is the trauma from occlusion. So because of the occlusal forces there is a destruction, zone of destruction, because of that there is a periodontitis. So we must say that there is a trauma from occlusion. So if you see that there are some clinical features of the trauma from occlusion, and you can remember it from the mnemonic WARM. So W is our widening of the PDL. These are very important features, guys, very important classical features of the trauma from occlusion. So you must remember all these features. Then A, we have angular bone loss. So always remember that the bone loss in case of trauma from occlusion is never horizontal. It is always the angular bone loss. There is no pocket which is seen. Never horizontal. Horizontal, never. And also we never see the pocket also. So absence of pocket and presence of angular bone loss is a classical feature of the trauma from occlusion. So the injury, the tissue injury is in such a way that there is an angular bone loss without the periodontal pocket, and because of this the tooth get loosen up. So R is the root resorption, or bone resorption also you can say. And M is our mobility, so loosening of the teeth. Very important. These are the most important features, that is widening of the PDL we see in case of trauma from occlusion. Angular bone loss is a typical characteristic feature. Otherwise, usually what happens when there is a periodontitis, there is a horizontal bone loss. But what do we see in case of trauma from occlusion when there are excessive occlusal forces? Because so much forces are coming onto the teeth that the patient teeth cannot take up the load. Either the forces are high or the capacity of the PDL is low, is poor, that they cannot take up the load. So any of the reason can be, there is angular bone loss. There is never horizontal bone loss. There is an angular bone loss without the periodontal pocket and teeth becomes loose. So there is a resorption and a mobility, that is the tooth loosening, are the classical features of the trauma from occlusion. This you have to remember. And according to the Glickman, there are classifications from the trauma from occlusion. So trauma from occlusion can be classified into primary and secondary, guys. Primary is, that means the reason is due to the increased occlusal forces. That means the forces are heavy. Secondary is when the ability of the tissues cannot resist the occlusal forces. That means weak periodontal tissues. When the tissues cannot take up the load. So there is problem with the tissues. So that is the secondary trauma from occlusion. And also acute and chronic. Acute is when it happens all of a sudden. So what happens when you are breaking a walnut or something like this? So when there is a all of a sudden excessive forces. Now what happens? This is what we are talking about, trauma from occlusion. Guys, let's understand one more thing. What happens to the PDL? This is the PDL. So suppose this is the PDL here we have. So what happens to the PDL when there are heavy forces, when there are no forces? When we do not apply any force, in absence of forces, we can say insufficient forces. So insufficient forces, when the forces are not coming to the periodontal ligament of the tooth, so what happens? There is a thinning or narrowing of the periodontal ligament, and also the reason is the atrophy of the fibers. So because fibers are not working, they are always resting, so they are not working, so what happens? There is a thinning. This is also an injurious process. Also, guys, we see the osteoporosis of the bone, alveolar bone, and reduction in the bone height. This is when there are insufficient forces, that means close to no forces, less forces. What happens when there are heavy forces or excess forces? This is what do we call the trauma from occlusion. That means trauma, injury from, due to occlusion. Occlusal forces. So when there is an injury due to occlusal forces, we call it, due to excess of occlusal forces, we call it the trauma from occlusion. And we have already studied what happens when there are trauma from occlusion. There is widening of the PDL, there is tooth mobility, then WARM. So we have to write W means widening of the PDL, A means angular bone loss without the pocket. Always remember, without the pocket. So minus pocket. Without the pocket. So pocket will never be there. And there is a resorption and mobility. So these are the features when there is a excessive occlusal forces. Insufficient forces, there is narrowing of the PDL because PDL is not working. Excessive forces, there is a widening of the PDL. So this is a very characteristic feature which you have to remember about the PDL, that what happens when there are excessive forces coming onto the PDL, when there are insufficient forces coming onto the PDL. So forces. So guys, what happens when there is an injury? So in case of an injury, or we have studied that in the orthodontic lecture series, that the pressure tension theory. So suppose if force is applied from this side. So this is the application of the force. So there is going to be the movement of the tooth on the opposite side. So this side where there is a movement of the tooth, this is our pressure side. And the other side is the tension side, from where the forces are applied. So since I've told you in the orthodontic lecture series as well, so when the forces are applied, so in order for the tooth to move, so there should be a space in the bone. So that means this is the resorption. This is the side where the resorption takes place. So this is the side where the resorption takes place, right? So here there is resorption of the bone. And the other side, which is the tension side, now the space will be created. So tooth will move like this, right? So there is a space which is created after the tooth moves. So there is a deposition of the bone on the opposite side. So we see the deposition on the tension side. So osteoblastic activity we see on the tension side, osteoclastic activity we see on the pressure side. So tension side there is a osteoblastic activity which we see, and this was our pressure tension theory. So what happens when there are slight excessive forces? Not so much excessive, just the slight forces we can say. So in case of our tension side, I mean this side is the pressure side where there is a resorption, and when there is a slight excessive forces which we see on the pressure side, so there will be the resorption of the alveolar bone, resorption of the bone and widening of the PDL, right? And what do we see in the tension side is elongation of the PDL, elongation of the PDL. So what will happen, guys? There will be elongation of the periodontal ligament fibers which we see on the tension side. So there is the elongation of the PDL, and we also see that there is a apposition of the bone. So what happens, there is a formation of the bone. So apposition of the bone we see, that means the deposition of the bone. We will see the osteoblastic activity. In case if there is an increased tension, so blood vessel get enlarged. But if in case there is an increased pressure, then the blood vessels are reduced. So blood vessels in case of the tension increases, but what happens in case of pressure, the blood vessels reduces, the number of the blood vessels reduces in the size. Now this was about when there is a slight pressure. What about when we apply excess pressure on the tooth? So in case of a greater pressure or greater forces, when we apply greater forces, what happens that we see on the pressure side, there is a compression of the PDL, compression of the PDL, necrosis of the PDL. So the PDL will undergo hyalinization. So the fibroblast and the neck, there is going to be the fibroblastic activity and disintegration of the blood vessels wall. So they will release their content into the surrounding tissues, and this will increase the resorption of the bone because of the inflammatory substances. So this is what do we see in case of the pressure side. What do we see in case of a tension side? There is a widening of the PDL. Widening of the PDL we observe, as well as guys, there is tearing of the PDL. Tearing of the PDL. So what will happen? They will stretch and then eventually they will tear. So this is kind of advanced stages. So first of all there will be widening and then there will be tearing. In the later on, if we keep on applying the pressure, so these widened stretched PDL, they will tear eventually. And also we see the blood vessels are enlarged. Now what happens when there are severe forces applied, or we can say what happens when there are continuous trauma from occlusion, when there are continuous forces applied? So we see in case of the pressure side, what happens? The necrosis of the PDL and the bone. And guys, the resorption of the bone continues. Resorption of the bone continues from the periodontal ligament, and all the adjacent structures become necrosed, and therefore we see the undermining resorption. Undermining resorption. Resorption. And what do we see in case of the tension side, there is widening of the PDL. Then, because of the widening of the PDL, we see the tearing of the PDL. So, first of all, they will get stretched and eventually they will tear. And also, in case of excessive pressure, in case when there are excessive forces are applied on the tension side also, eventually there will be resorption. So, what do we see here, guys? What is the conclusion? So, eventually, because of the very heavy occlusal forces, high excess occlusal forces, it results in the tissue injury. So, there is a resorption because of the tissue injury. And furcation areas are the most susceptible areas. So, furcation is the most susceptible area to injury from the trauma from occlusion. Most susceptible to trauma from occlusion. So, this we have to remember it for the exam viewpoint. So, guys, we know that trauma from occlusion is when there are occlusal, heavy occlusal forces which are applied on the tissues, and if there is reduced capacity, reduced ability of the tissues to take this load, we call it the secondary trauma from occlusion. If there are excessive forces, occlusal forces, we call it the primary trauma from occlusion. So, what are the stages of the tissue response to these increased forces? So, the first stage is our injury stage. This is what we have talked about. So, the pressure tension. So, this is due to injury. So, first stage is the injury. Second stage is the repair stage. Now, what happens? These damaged tissues are removed and there is a new periodontal tissues. So, new periodontal tissues are formed, appear, and they restore these injured tissue. So, there is a buttress bone formation we see. Talking about the third stage, we have is the adaptive remodeling. So, remodeling, we know that it is a combination of the resorption as well as deposition. So, this remodeling is the adaptive remodeling. So, adaptive response. If repair is not enough, the periodontium remodels itself so that the forces are no longer injurious to the tissues. So, the forces are no longer harming the tissues. So, periodontal ligaments, they get widened up. So, this because of this remodeling process, what happens if the forces keep on continue? So, periodontium has to take action now. This is the high time. So, before getting burst, blasted, so these periodontal fibers, what happens? They widened. So, they widened and they form a funnel shape. So, they form a funnel shape. We see the funnel shaped PDL at the crest. And also there are angular defects in the bone. Angular defects in the bone. Or we can say these V-shaped defects. So, the bone, there will be resorption like this, in the angular, horizontal or oblique way. Also, we never see a pocket. So, always remember, when we are talking about trauma from occlusion, there is never a pocket. So, it is not associated with a pocket formation and the teeth becomes finally loose. There is a mobility which we observe. So, trauma from occlusion, let's cover some few important points here. So, trauma from occlusion affects the supporting structures like the periodontal ligament, the alveolar bone. Affects. What all it affects? The supporting tissues. And what about gingiva? It never affects the gingiva and its blood supply. So, does it causes pocket formation? No, it never causes the pocket formation. Does it cause gingivitis? No, it never causes gingivitis. Does it cause periodontitis? Yes, it causes periodontitis. It does not initiate gingivitis or periodontitis, but it contributes to the risk factor for the progression and the severity of the periodontitis. So, it doesn't directly cause periodontitis or periodontal pockets. And what about pocket we have covered? So, it does not cause the gingivitis or pockets, but it will contribute to the risk factor. So, it will contribute to the severity of the disease. And the most common sign we see is the mobility, tooth mobility. So, if all the options are given and if they are asking the most common sign, so most common sign of the TFO is the tooth mobility. So, what are the radiographic signs for the trauma from occlusion? So, we know that there is a bone loss which is in an angular way. So, we see a vertical bone loss or angular bone loss we can say. So, guys, vertical bone loss, there is a widening of the PDL, so increase in the width of the PDL space. The normal PDL average we say is 0.20 millimeter, right? So, there is a widening of the PDL. And we also see that there is radiolucency. Radiolucency and condensation of the alveolar bone. And guys, root resorption. So, these are all the signs which we see radiographically. And how do we diagnose it? So, see guys, you have to remember this. Trauma from occlusion, the main cause of the trauma from occlusion is either it can be occlusal disharmony. So, we have to treat the occlusal disharmony. Whenever we talk about the treatment of any disease, we first eliminate the etiology. So, it can be occlusal disharmony, it can be some parafunctional habits, or it can be due to improper restoration. So, there can be many reasons for this. So, how do we treat it? So, guys, if there is a tooth mobility, we have to reduce the tooth mobility. How do we reduce the tooth mobility? We are going to give the splints, right? So, we have to do the splinting for this. If there is occlusal disharmony, then we have to do the occlusal adjustments. So, when we talk about occlusal adjustment, we talk about the bull rule. That means we only touch the buccal surfaces of the upper teeth, lower surfaces, lingual surfaces of the lower teeth. So, these are the teeth which we do the selective grinding. See, these are the cusp of the selective grinding. We have already covered in our CD series. So, you can watch the express revision course for the complete denture. You will find the selective grinding. So, guys, first of all, there can be, when we are talking about occlusal disharmony, so we can do the adjustment, that is the selective grinding, or any prosthetic rehabilitation. So, occlusal, giving new occlusal scheme. So, we can also give the therapeutic occlusion. We can change the, if there is an abnormal occlusal scheme, so we can correct the occlusal schemes. Therapeutic. Occlusion. Or also if there are due to some other reasons, we can also give the orthodontic treatment. Then guys, extraction, if the diagnosis of the teeth is hopeless. So for the hopeless teeth, we have to go for extraction. So guys, these are the treatment for the secondary trauma from occlusion. So you remember, secondary trauma from occlusion is due to the inability of the tissues to withstand the occlusal forces. What if the occlusal forces itself are very high? So when we talk about the primary trauma from occlusion, how do we treat it? So we have to eliminate the excessive forces. So how do we eliminate the excessive forces? If it is due to any of the occlusion, we have to do the occlusal adjustments, guys. So occlusal adjustment, if it is due to, for example, say plunger cusp, so that also we have to do the occlusal adjustment. So it can be due to any reasons, because there is a occlusal disharmony, so we can give the occlusal adjustment. We can do the selective grinding of the teeth. So selective grinding means we cannot grind whole of the teeth, we only have to grind selective teeth, which is the bull cusp. So buccal, upper, lower lingual, right? Then guys, if the patient is having parafunctional habit, then we have to control the habit. So we can give some ortho appliances, and then we can also give the night guard to the patient, say in case of bruxism, and rehabilitation, occlusal rehabilitation. So these are the treatments for the trauma from occlusion. Now, as I told you, and we can also do the coronoplasty, guys. Coronoplasty. So which is basically adjusting the teeth. That means selective reduction of the occlusal surfaces. Occlusally, we are reducing the selective reduction. We are doing the selective reduction. So that is corono means crown, and plasty means reshaping. So we can reshape the crown. And guys, one of the reason can be a plunger cusp. So what is a plunger cusp? Basically, it is a cusp. So this is suppose upper teeth and these are the lower teeth. Now what happens when all of the food, it gets accumulated interproximally in the opposite area? So all of the food actually gets accumulated interproximally. So there is a food accumulation here. So this is when, because of the cusp, the food wedges into interproximal area. So this is, we call it the plunger cusp. It is the force, it is the cusp which wedge the food into the interproximal areas. Now usually what happens, guys, usually the food is directed like this way, not in the interproximal area. So this is the normal scenario. But here what happens in case of a plunger cusp, the food wedges interproximally. So this is the plunger cusp. And what happens when the food get accumulated or dislodged into interproximally, then the person, individual, the patient complains of urge of digging, same like pocket, you remember? But in the pocket it was the urge of digging into the gums, but here the urge of digging in between the teeth, because we are talking about interproximal area. So the patient usually complains of the feeling of the pressure or any urge of digging into the in between the teeth. So the patient also complains of vague pain which radiates into the jaw, deep into the jaw. And also, because we know that there is an interproximal food lodgment. Because of this interproximal food lodgment, all the times, so there is an inflammation process which initiates. So this interproximal food lodgment, we call it the lateral food impaction. So because of this food impaction, there is an inflammation, gingival inflammation. Also, there can be recession. And if it still precedes, then there can be destruction of the bone, destruction of the alveolar bone, and or there can be a root caries when it goes deep inside. So lateral food impaction is when the food is impacted laterally. So guys, lateral food impaction is when the food is coming into the interproximal area from the lateral pressure. So either there can be pressure from the lips, there can be pressure from the cheeks, or there can be pressure from the tongue. So like that, from the lateral side, when the food is coming and it is lodging into the interproximal area, is what do we call the lateral food impaction. And this is what do we see in case of a plunger cusp. So there is a food impaction which we see in a plunger cusp. So forcefully there is food lodgment, there is wedging of the food into the interproximal area by the occlusal forces again. So there can be, the reason can be due to supra eruption of the antagonist teeth, which is the opposite teeth, if there is a supra eruption, or if there is any loss of the proximal interproximal support. So for example, if there is opening up of the contact, then also food can go and lodge into the interproximal area. Or if there are any uneven occlusal contacts because of occlusal wear, adhesion, we can say. So because of that, usually the patient has got pain in the jaws, recession, and there is inflammation, some degrees of inflammation in the PDL as well, and usually it is associated with a periodontal pocket. But if we see the trauma from occlusion, remember trauma from occlusion, you have to remember this is always, always, always there is absence of pocket. So what do we see in case of trauma from occlusion? Trauma from occlusion, this is plunger. One second, guys. Okay, so what are the features of trauma from occlusion which we have studied? So guys, WARM, widening of the PDL, angular bone loss, resorption, as well as the tooth mobility. And we see that funnel shape, we see that there is a funnel shape widening of the PDL. So the PDL, this is the PDL which becomes the funnel shape at the crest. Also, we see the angular defect. Now, usually guys, what happens whenever there is a periodontitis, we see that there is a horizontal bone loss. But in case of trauma from occlusion, we always see angular bone loss. So, which is the vertical bone loss. This is the difference between a normal periodontitis when this is because of the plaque, there is inflammation. So, the reason is the horizontal, it leads into the horizontal bone loss. But what if there are heavy occlusal forces on the top of a plaque? So, we see that there is an angular bone loss, and this we have covered in the Glickman's concept. So since Glickman told you that because of the heavy forces, you can see here, because of the heavy forces going into the periodontium, so there is an angular defect. But otherwise, what happens when there is plaque accumulation, there is inflammation which goes from this side, so there is a horizontal bone loss. So this is about the trauma from occlusion. I hope that you have enjoyed the video. If you have enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up. Also, you can comment in the comment section below, because this motivates me to put more videos for you and to make free notes for you guys. So guys, you can support us on Paytm as well as on PayPal to make free videos for you. So till then, keep reading, keep learning, stay motivated. All the best for your exam. I'll see you soon in the next video.